Welcome everyone to the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee's 31st meeting of 2020. Our first item today is to decide whether to take item 5, which is consideration of evidence heard on the Scottish Parliament's environmental performance and response to the climate emergency in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. Our second item today is an evidence session on the Scottish Parliament's environmental performance and response to the climate emergency. And I'd like to welcome David McGill, the Clerk Chief Executive, Lindsay Hamill, the Group Head of Resilience and Sustainability, and Maureen Lynch, Environmental Performance Manager of the Scottish Parliament. Good morning to you all, colleagues. I just want to say ahead of this, members are, I've got a range of questions, but if members want to ask a supplementary on anyone else and we have time, if you just use the chat box and put an R in it, and I'll try and fit as many questions in as possible. David, the Parliament is on track to deliver quite a few areas in environmental performance, but not in others. The recent Sustainable Development Annual Report highlighted a couple of areas for improvement. Not unsurprisingly, business travel was an issue, although I imagine that this year has put a paid to a lot of that difficulty. But in general, of course, the Parliament does, members of the Parliament in particular, do go to a lot of places in order to perform their work. Could you give me an idea of which areas of the environmental performance are still challenging to tackle and why, and give me an idea of how you're planning to address it?
Yeah, good morning, Convener. And I think your characterisation of where we are with our performance is really accurate. We have a very good overall message to relay. Our carbon footprint has gone down by 56% since our base year, which is 2005-2006, which is the first full year of occupation of this building. However, some of the individual targets within that were not quite meeting the targets that we've set ourselves. So, for example, in relation to electricity, to waste, to water, we're falling just marginally short of the targets we set by an error of about 1 or 2%. So we have to redouble our efforts there. I mean, I think the targets are very ambitious and stretching, as they should be, but we want to get a push to meet these targets, the performance here, hit the target levels. There are a few sticking points. You mentioned business travel. That's always been a difficult one for us. There's a balance there to be struck between the very important role that members perform in meeting with constituents, going out and about in their constituencies, but that being a contributing factor to our overall carbon footprint. So we have a business travel plan in place, but we're going to refresh that for session 6. That's currently under active review at the moment, to try and get a better balance there, learn some of the lessons that we've learned with the last 7 or 8 months, and the way things have been restructured to operate during the pandemic, and make sure those are factored into thinking with business travel plans. Other areas that cause us a bit of difficulty are in relation to zero emissions ambition, and just getting full guidance from the government of what that means for public sector organisations, so that we can map what we are doing with other public sector organisations. We also have, I mean, the biggest, by far and away, the biggest component of our carbon usage is energy requirements. So we've been trying to stimulate discussion, have been stimulating discussion over a district heating network with various other partners in the vicinity. That's a very complex process. It's difficult to see how we lead through all of that, but there's something that we're very committed to. We've instigated this conversation, and it's something we want to drive through to completion.
Just, I want to ask you, how important do you think it is that Scottish Parliament leads the way? You know, it's our national parliament. Do you think that that's important that we're leading the way and we seem to be leading the way?
I think it's absolutely vital. I mean, this organisation, the political side of this organisation, like, has set world-leading targets in relation to climate change and environmental performance. I think it's therefore incumbent on the Parliament as an institution to lead the way. across the public sector and how we contribute to the overall national targets and the international aspirations here. I think it's an area that we can't step back from. We need to be right at the forefront of all of this. We need to be displaying best practice to all of our public sector partners in particular.
You've mentioned that obviously you're doing a scope 3 inventory and assessment. Can I ask when that's going to be complete and whether the future SPCB environmental performance targets encompass that the expanded scope 3 emissions?
Yeah, if you don't mind, Cadina, I think that may be a question that's better answered by my colleague Maureen Lynch. She's been more closely associated with this.
Maureen.
Hi there. Yeah, so the Scope 3 inventory and assessment is going to be completed as part of the updated carbon management plan. And the more detailed Scope 3 prioritisation strategy we hope to publish in 2021-22. So our current carbon targets do include some Scope 3 in relation to our operational waste, our water and our business travel, which is in line with the public sector. But we plan to collect data and gain an understanding of our Scope 3 from home working emissions for next year's Sustainable Development Annual Plan, because we feel that's very important given the circumstances with COVID. So the inclusion of an extended Scope 3 emissions will be dependent on the outcome of the inventory and assessment and the prioritisation strategy. It will highlight where to focus our efforts, and it will be dependent on the level of emissions in relation to spend, the quality of the data that we have available, and also the influence the Parliament has to reduce Scope 3 emissions. So overall, it's expected that our understanding of our Scope 3 emissions will improve over the next few years, and our performance targets will be set. However, it's likely to be within a separate target than our current operational carbon footprint, and it may focus on qualitative rather than quantitative targets, depending on the data that we have available.
Thank you very much. Just a final question for me before I hand over to my colleagues, and it's for David. In terms of a lot of the decisions that have to be made around the action points you've talking about, I mean, I wonder if you could just explain, obviously people will be watching this that aren't working in the Parliament. A lot of the decisions do lie with the corporate bodies, so things that are sticking points that impact particularly on members and how they operate. Can you explain just, you know, how that works in terms of, you know, it has to be the corporate body that takes a lot of these very difficult decisions? And off the back of that, you mentioned some things that have happened during the pandemic that might give us some inkling as to how we can improve in the future.
Yeah, well, on the first point, obviously the corporate body is the decision maker here, but we've got a whole governance arrangement round about that to support the corporate body in that function. We do have a Sustainable Development Board, which Lindsay Hamill chairs. Her role as Group Head for Resilience and Sustainability was specifically designed by me to provide a strategic focus on environmental performance, climate change, sustainable development, and it brings together many of the offices that lead in this area. But obviously there's a cross-organisation effort here. So the board supports the corporate body in that decision making. It also guides the Parliament's leadership group, its senior management team, in providing that support to the corporate body. So the governance structure is really quite robust in that sense. On the second point, we are working with various parts of the organisation on what can be done to leverage some of the benefits that we've seen in terms of environmental performance this year. So you'd be well aware that the presiding officer issued a survey last month to MSPs. That survey got a good response. It was in relation to the types of things that members might want to retain post-COVID. The conveners group that you attended last week had a very good discussion about this. Both of those things have shown that there is some appetite for continuing some aspects of business, but that's not across the board. There are lots of disbenefits that members have identified, and some of those are very much in relation to sustainability issues. Sustainability obliges us to look at social and emotional needs, and sometimes that can come into conflict a bit with environmental performance. So it's not quite as easy to say we can stop all of this travel, we can do everything online, because that really cuts across the social and environmental needs of constituents. Some of them in very crisis situations, members deal with this all the time. So there's a big balance to be struck there. The Procedures Committee is currently looking at the temporary standing orders that were put in place. So it's launched an inquiry. The evidence that's been gathered from the corporate body, from the presiding officer's survey, from the conveners group discussion will feed into that inquiry. And I think it may be sometime next year before that committee reports on what might change and what should revert to the pre-COVID situation. That'll be really informative for us, but as a staff group, it won't define how we do things. It'll let us know how members want to do things, but it means that functions won't be in the scope of those discussions. So there's wider ability for us to redesign how we think, how we do things to support members and how we do things to support parliamentary business.
Thank you. I'll move on to members' questions. Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much, Convener. David, I just want to ask a few technical questions first, just to make sure I've baselined what might follow. And in relation to business travel, I just got a slight hint that business travel includes the travel that MSPs will claim in expenses. And I just wanted to be clear that that is actually part of what we're counting as business travel associated with the Parliament. David?
It is, yes. I mean, our starting point is anything that impinges on environmental performance as a result of this organisation existing, if you like, that's where Scope 3 takes us. So we're not looking to exclude certain parts of activity that are a direct result of this organisation existing. So yes, that business travel that you refer to would be part of our thinking here.
Right. Well, that's good. I wonder if the corporate body and yourselves as the executives of the Parliament have considered how business travel might relate to active travel, because one of the avoidable sources of business travel might be the elimination of short journeys from car journeys, from taxi use. Now, taxi use is clearly not a huge carbon footprint for the Parliament, but nonetheless, it's there and we could do something about it. And in particular, it grieves me from time to time to see colleagues who appear to me to be fit enough to do otherwise, getting in taxis at the door of the Parliament to go to our station, when, for my part, I find it's a 13-minute walk. So what encouragement can we give to members and indeed to staff to participate in the active travel agenda for its own sake, but also to be part of that reducing our business travel footprint, and in particular, perhaps looking at the members' expenses scheme to exclude small claims that relate to business travel to encourage people to use large carbon footprint travel only where it is necessary and to use other alternatives when it's not.
Yeah, these are things that we are actively looking at. So when we're looking at business travel, it's not necessarily just reducing all of that and moving things online. It's not converting it from physical travel to just online activity. It is looking at promoting active travel. We do have an annual active travel survey, and that's fairly well responded to. The response rate could be better, so we'll work on all of that. I think what you're hinting at here is a serious behaviour change. And that's what we're looking at. We're really challenging ourselves to go a bit further than we normally would. So, for example, in relation to taxis that you've mentioned there, we understand that the government has cancelled its taxi contracts. So we're looking to do that, looking at what the implications of all of that are. I mean, that's quite challenging. So if we turn that tap off, we need to see what support we can give to building users to get around on those short journeys. But it's something that I think we're looking to really try and drive that behavioural change that you're hinting at.
Thank you, David. That's encouraging. I must say that the COVID crisis for me personally, as someone who's relatively remote from Parliament, has eliminated on average for each sitting week 12 hours travel. Some weeks are quite different from others. So the continuing provision of electronic participation in parliamentary proceedings is something that's very, very important. Given that we continue to use for parliamentary activities two different electronic platforms, and I have a view that that contributes to some difficulties for those who are not so comfortable with electronic use. Are we going to look at the technologies that we use for electronic participation and help the presiding officer perhaps get us to a position where things like the taking of interventions during debates can return for electronic purposes? Because although we're close to being present in the way we do it online, there are still some constraints that I think people regard as relatively large impediments to our with the current provision adopting fully electronic participation. So as part of our heading towards zero emissions, what role are we going to continue to see the electronic participation playing?
I think we will continue to see that playing a very important role. I mean, I think at the very least, notwithstanding what members might say in relation to what the Procedures Committee is currently sponsoring, at the very least, this is our resilience measure, this is our business continuity measure. So for in situations like this or other situations that militate against members getting together physically, this is our response to that. Now, you'll appreciate that the response that we put in place wasn't a planned response in any way, and it was put in place at high speed. That's not to say that we didn't put all of our efforts into making sure it was as robust as possible, but we do recognise the limitations between having two different platforms on which members are able to participate. The imperative really was that all members were able to do that. At the beginning, we had members who were not able to travel to Edinburgh because they were in the shielding category. We had other members who were choosing not to travel to Edinburgh. So it was vitally important that all members were able to participate. We didn't go down the proxy route that other parliaments have gone down because we wanted to treat every member the same. But we do recognise that difficulty, and it was always part of our thinking that the prize here really was an integrated system that allowed members to do everything on one platform. We simply haven't had the capacity to move any way towards that yet, but it's sitting there in the background. And if and when we do get some time, whether it's in the run-up to the next election or over the parliamentary recess next summer, that's something that we'll be putting a lot of effort into.
Well, finally, on the electronic communication, before I come to a very brief question on electricity, one of the parts of resilience, because you put all this in the context of resilience, and I understand why you should properly have done that. The weak link often appears to be the links for which members, perhaps in their personal capacity or via their offices, are responsible for, is that broadband connection, commonly addressed as Wi-Fi. To what extent can the Parliament perhaps lift some of the burden of making that work in a consistent and as reliable as it reasonably can be way for members? Because I think one of the recurring things we see is people feeling that their link is causing them difficulties, and indeed recognising that people are experiencing difficulties, although the diagnosis might be open to some question. So to what extent can Parliament perhaps, in the drive to zero, help make sure that our links are more effective than perhaps some people's have been?
Yeah, I mean, there is a limit to what the Parliament can do here, but we don't absolve ourselves from having working with some internet providers in some local areas. And we have had some successes here. We've probably got more leeway with local offices and where we can get members from their homes to their local offices to participate. There's more that we can do in that environment. But we do take a bit of responsibility here. If we're providing this ability for members to work from home, we do take a bit of responsibility for making sure that their infrastructure is robust enough to allow them to do that. So we continue working with internet service providers where we can to improve the service that the members have so that they can have confidence when they try to participate in proceedings remotely.
Right. Now, finally and briefly, I notice you in your remarks to the Gemeinde referred to electricity as one area where we're a little behind our target. And I note from the numbers that our electric carbon footprint, rather to my surprise, is greater than our gas one at over well over 1,000 tonnes. And I just wonder to what extent we're going to be able to get that under control either by reducing our consumption of electricity, which is broadly something I guess we'd want to do, but also by sourcing electricity from renewable sources, which is another way in which we could reduce. And I just wonder what the focus is on that. And that's my last question, Camilla.
I think, again, this is probably something that my colleague Maureen Lynch would be better placed to answer.
Oh, hi there. Yeah, I think so currently our electricity, we do pay to have to be on a low carbon tariff, but we do report our emissions in line with DEFRA UK grid emissions, which is what we do for the Scottish Government public reporting. So I think it's just making sure, I think it's something we could look at in more detail, but I think it's making sure that any claims that we have about having 100% renewable energy or green energy is definitely from that type of tariff, and also showing that we don't have false negatives, because we do need to be in line with the UK grid emission factors when we're reporting our carbon.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. Thank you. I noticed that Mark Ruskell asked for a supplementary a few minutes to go. Mark, do you want to pick up on anything in the themes that have been mentioned so far?
Yeah, thanks. Just quickly, Convener. It was about local offices, actually. I mean, there's obviously the digital aspect of that, making sure they're effective, but there's also the you know, the energy issues around local offices as well. And you know, I'm aware that, you know, these aren't Parliament buildings. They're rented often from the private sector. So I'm just wondering if, as part of the carbon management plan, whether local offices are going to be factored into that, what kind of support there'll be for members, particularly at the start of taking up leases in the next session, to make sure that, you know, they're as efficient as they can be, and contracts are set out that are low carbon and energy efficient.
Yeah, again, we will be working with landlords and providers on that procurement office. A lot of work here and how we work with contractors, and we see this as a contractual relationship in securing carbon benefits. So for session six, we will be looking at working with landlords on the environmental performance of buildings that are for let. I'll go back to what I said earlier about us taking responsibility for everything that is generated by this Parliament's activity. So that does include local offices. So they will be brought into the scope of our environmental performance targets. That being the case, it's incumbent on us to make sure that we're not burdening ourselves with unnecessary waste in terms of energy use here. We'll be doing what we can to make sure that accommodation providers are aware of that and taking their responsibility for the performance of their buildings.
And just with that carbon management plan, that will be up and ready in March 21, yeah? So it will be ready for new members coming in.
That's certainly our aim just now, yes.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, and on that, can I come to Claudia Beamish?
David, and to Lindsay and Maureen. Some of the areas that I'm planning to cover have been helpfully answered already, but in terms of decision making and governance, the Parliament, as has been highlighted, is recently established sustainable strategies. I understand this defines four areas of work: climate change scrutiny, external engagement, and embedding sustainable development thinking. And this is referenced in your in the Sustainable Development Annual Report for 2019-20. Could you explore a little further with us, David, or one of your colleagues, how the Parliament Sustainable Development and Climate Change Strategy developed? And is this a public document? And if so, how do the public access it?
The board that I referenced earlier on is chaired by Lindsay Hamill, Head for Resilience and Sustainability. So she's involved in developing the strategy. So maybe I'll hand over to her to give you the detail that you're looking for.
Hello there, good morning. Yes, as David has mentioned before, we have a Sustainable Development Board, which I chair with many of my colleagues from across the Parliament. And we worked collaboratively to set out what our Session 6 strategy was going to be. And our role is to recommend that strategy both to the leadership group and then for corporate body for final approval. And once that strategy is approved by the corporate, yes, the SBCB, which we're expecting to be early next year, then that will be a published document at that point, and that would be published on the Parliament's website and accessible to anybody who wanted to see that. In developing the strategy, we're very cognizant that we're moving out of a purely environmental plan, which we've had, you know, operating in the Parliament for quite some time now, and expanding into more sustainable development thinking, and very aware of the you know, the recent changes in regulations and our requirements under those. So as David said, and as in our plan, we have four pillars to that strategy. They're still under development, but the four pillars are defined. So the first one is around climate change. And under that, our carbon management plan will sit. It'll make up a large part of that climate change plan. And whilst we aren't yet ready to publish our targets around that, because that'll be through our governance strategy, we are aware of our requirements under regulations. And so our Session 6 strategy runs until 2026. That's clearly very close to 2030. And the requirements and regulations are that by 2030, we'd have a 75% reduction in our net emissions. And so that's very much our thinking towards what targets we will be setting ourselves under climate change. Our scrutiny strategy is very focused on how, as an institution, the Parliament holds government to account and how we can do that through the lens of sustainability. So that's looking at how we can expand some of the thinking which I know this committee is already using in its scrutiny of legislation across other committees, and really strengthening our capacity in those areas. Our engagement pillar, which is our third pillar, is focused on our external engagement, and that's recognising the role that Parliament has as an institution and how we engage with others. So that's going to be quite focused on COP26 in the short term, and how we move into COP26 and take advantage of the part of Parliament's role and share that internationally and with our peers within the UK. It also focuses on just our visitors and our education programme, and how we do that in a more sustainable way, how we are more accessible to a wider range of people than perhaps traditionally have just been able to travel to the Parliament. And finally, and I think this is, you've alluded to this a couple of times, but behavioural change is going to be one of the biggest things that we have to tackle. And that's why we have a separate pillar, which is embedding sustainable development thinking. So that's, you know, really recognising that changing people's behaviour and embedding those changes will be one of the most difficult things that we do. And so our aim under there is to make sure that we've got a base level understanding across the organisation, that people understand sustainable development thinking. And then on the back of that, that all of the actions that we're taking around climate change scrutiny and engagement have a change management programme to support it, so we can really embed those behaviours. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Lindsay, for that detailed answer. And David, could I perhaps come back to you to ask you about the investments by the Scottish Parliament, and I'm of course aware that there are trustees as well. So it's as far as it's appropriate for you to answer the questions about investment. I'm wondering how the Parliament can be in the forefront of divesting from fossil fuels with a just transition, which would send a clear message internationally, which especially as we're leading up to COP, but in its own sake, is important. And I appreciate there are issues around fiduciary duties, but I think it's becoming clearer that there are also risks in stranded assets as well. So without going into too much detail from my perspective, because I'm actually asking a question rather than giving my view, or trying not to anyway. Could you explore that area with us a bit? And then I've just got a couple of other fairly short questions. Thank you.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I take it in relation to this question, you're looking at the Parliament's pension fund. Referenced the trustees in place there. Yeah. Well, I mean, you'll appreciate there is a separation of duties here. So the corporate body's role here is to appoint the fund trustees and to provide the resources for the employer contribution. The overall responsibility for the governance, management and administration of the pension fund lies with the trustees. Corporate body is aware, as are the trustees, that this is a regular issue of concern for lots of members. It comes up quite regularly in relation to questions to the corporate body, letters to the presiding officer. So I'm aware that there has been dialogue between the corporate body and the fund trustees. Fund trustees have gone away and considered all of this, but in order to keep that very proper and legal separation of duties, it's an area that the corporate body can't seek to direct the trustees on. So any approaches in this area would have to be made direct to the fund trustees.
Guidance, which for the record, and I think we'll discuss as a committee whether it's appropriate for us to write to get an update on that. As well as that, David, you've already touched on procurement issues in discussions with my colleague Stuart Stevenson. I'm wondering if there's anything further you can add about procurement in relation perhaps to the catering aspects or any other issues that you feel are appropriate in terms of procurement and parliamentary arrangements in the context of what we're discussing today. Thank you.
Yeah, our procurement office has provided a fantastic service to us. Environmental performance of all of the contracts that we get involved in. That active members of the board, which we've referred to a few times. So maybe Lindsay Hamill can give you a bit more detail on the contribution that the procurement office has made to our environmental performance.
Thank you.
Yes, okay. Yes, as David said, our head of procurement is an active member of the Sustainable Development Board, and the procurement office have been probably leading the way in terms of us as an institution, before, as you know, we've actually been able to detail out our strategy. They've been working for some time on this. So already the Sustainable Development Goals are integrated into the procurement strategy. And in the annual report, which is published, I think we highlighted some case studies of work we've already done. So they're very focused on fair work practices. That we do a lot of where we can, we're quite focused on employing small and medium sized enterprises in our supply chain, and I think they've got multiple examples of things like that they've been doing, and as I say, that they're a very active participant and will continue to be so on the board. Circular economy thinking is probably the next big thing. So the procurement strategy already has that embedded, and part of what they'll be working with us on is how we embed that change of thinking in the organisation. So really questioning if we need to procure something in the first place, if that need really does exist, how we can do that, either refurbishing or reusing existing rather than buying new. So actually one of the focuses I think the procurement will have is how we can procure less and how they can support us to do that.
Thank you. Lindsay, could you perhaps give us some, for the interest of ourselves and also the public, an example or two of how changes have happened? What any particular you've mentioned in the annual report that there's cases that where things have been altered, whether it was in food or purchase of furniture or paper or whatever it may be, you know, is there anything you could highlight, please?
Goodness, I'm almost sure there are, and I'm going to be very mean and call on my colleague Maureen Lynch, who helped pull together that report. She'll have to lift her fingertips quicker.
No, I think I would need to look into it and come back to you in writing with some examples.
And could I just turn finally from my questioning back to you, David? And you have touched, all of you, on a lot of this, but is there anything that you'd like to say or add about how the Parliament monitors and reports on progress? And, you know, in a sort of structured detail would be helpful. Thanks.
Sorry, I didn't quite catch all of that. Your connection wavered a bit.
I'm muttering a bit, I think, sorry. just how the Parliament monitors and reports on progress, if there was anything further you wanted to say about that, just as we're going forward. And I think that would be helpful perhaps for us to highlight in our legacy paper as well, you know, so it's important looking to the next session. Thank you.
Yes, monitoring performance is really important to us. I think that doesn't really stack up if vote on that, be accountable for that as well. So we take that aspect of it very seriously. So the main monitoring framework is through the Sustainable Development Annual Report, but also we have a quarterly reporting system so that we can see how things are developing and benchmark that against the previous quarter. Those quarterly performance reports are presented to, first of all, our leadership group. So all of the senior management can see how we're doing across the piece. They're then given to the corporate body on a quarterly basis, and the corporate body then publishes those as part of its papers once it's had the chance to analyse that. So the corporate body is given sight of this on a quarterly basis as well as an annual basis.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now questions from Finlay Carson.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Just, I think most of my questions have been covered. The one I wanted to ask, now, whilst it's all very commendable, whatever that we look, and quite rightly look at performance of the Parliament and reducing our carbon footprint, ultimately the priority of the Parliament, and David, your job is to ensure that it carries out its function. That gives us as elected members the opportunity to represent our constituents and bring forward legislation, whatever. So what weight, how do you balance it out? Because it's all very well saying we need to cut down on travel, but ultimately I need to go and meet my constituents. It's important that we keep talking about the Scottish Parliament, the People's Parliament. It's important we get people into the Parliament. How do you balance that off to make sure that short-term gains, you know, reducing the amount of we use our cars when they're still fossil fuels. How do you balance it to make sure that we are performing our primary function, that is to represent our constituents?
Yeah, I mean, it's a difficult balance. I mean, I think the committee has environmental performance is not captured as part of the Parliament's highest level strategic plan. And that's for the reasons that you've alluded to here. The strategic plan sets out the Parliament's primary functions, and we've captured those as legislating, holding the government to account, and debating issues on behalf of the people of Scotland. Below that, we have a level of good governance, and that's where we capture our environmental performance. So the delivery plan, which supports the strategic plan, talks about having a sustainable development plan, and it talks about high quality effective governance. So that's the hook there that we then bring that in to support the Parliament's primary functions. But going beyond that, we do recognise that these things come into conflict. And the Parliament exists to support members in carrying out their duties. And a lot of that, as I said previously, is about representing your constituents, meeting your constituents, working with people and organisations in the local areas, working towards the national policies. And lots of that needs to be done by travel, supporting all of that. So I think what our aim here is looking at our statutory obligations as the baseline, and we do have public sector duties on us for our environmental performance, but going beyond that so that we can build in what I was saying to the convener earlier about being more of an exemplar organisation. So it's finding ways in which things can be done differently, things can be done better, finding ways in which the demands on the environment from our activities can be minimised, but not saying that members can't do things or shouldn't do things that they clearly need to do to fulfil their functions. It's an ongoing dilemma for us, but it's one that we discuss regularly through the board, so we've got lots of kind of active consideration of all of this. We work with national and international partners to make sure that we're keyed into best practice here. We look at what other organisations are doing. We seek to learn from others as well. So it'll be an ongoing tension, but one that I think we have to manage in a dynamic way.
Okay, thank you, David.
Thank you. And now to questions from Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks, convener. If I could just turn to aspects of climate change scrutiny and how we perform that as an institution. You'll be aware, of course, of the recommendations that this committee has made in relation to that, quite detailed recommendations and a sort of timescale for implementation. I mean, can I just start with that? I mean, do you agree with the recommendations that we've put forward there? And is that something that you're working towards? Are there any areas which you don't feel are appropriate to take forward at this point? If you give us an update on that, that'd be great.
Yeah, the recommendations that the committee has made have really welcomed, and they're going to be really valuable for us in developing the overall strategy for Session 6. So what we've done with the recommendations that provided is we've handed them over lock, stock and barrel to the board and asked the board to integrate them into its thinking for the strategy, so they'll all be considered as a package, and hopefully they'll all work through into our overall Session 6 strategy. So as I say, they've been really welcomed. And any more support, thoughts, recommendations that the committee wants to make will be enthusiastically received by us.
Okay. So are there decisions that need to be made ahead of the next election then? So I'm thinking in particular about, you know, standing order changes that might be required in terms of how the Parliament actually scrutinises climate change. I mean, one of the suggestions, for example, was I think forming a kind of subgroup of conveners. You know, there might be a change in you know, the remits of certain committees. I don't know. I mean, how far progressed is that kind of consideration?
I think from the corporate body's point of view, that's not something that the corporate body.
We appear can to
get into the territory of standing
for a minute. David, we lost you for the start of that answer. I wonder if you could start again, because we lost a good few seconds.
Okay, no problem. Yeah, what we're saying is that in terms of standing orders changes, that's not natural territory for the corporate body. So there are lots of decisions to be taken here, but the corporate body's interest is in providing the Parliament and its committees with the resources required for its functions. So considerations about what needs to change in terms of the Parliament's rules, probably for other bodies, for the Bureau, for the Procedures Committee, and ultimately for the Parliament as a whole. But all of the recommendations that might lead people to decide that changes need to be made to the standing orders of the Parliament will be considered. It's our aim to have the strategy signed off this side of the election. It will be a strategy for Session 6, but decisions will be taken in the early part of next year, so that before we go into the election period, that is published as our strategy for Session 6.
OK, Okay, so in terms of lining that up then, are you confident that the other parts of the institution will be able to make those decisions? Because clearly, you know, you're it's going to be a big rush of work at the start of session six, you know, setting up really new committees, training members, all of that work, embedding sustainable development into our work. Is that, are you confident you've got enough time and enough steerage from Dutch Parliament to enable you to do that work, or there's still unanswered questions in your strategy where you're going to have to wait until early session six to find out what's going on?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm confident that we can put ourselves into a very good position here. I mean, there are things that are out with our control, and there's more data that we need in order to really nail down a lot of the detail. But in terms of the strategy, I'm very confident we're not starting from a standing position just now. Lots of these things have been under active consideration for a long time. For example, the environmental targets that we've been working towards for the time that we've been in this building were always due to expire this year. So we knew that we needed to have something beyond that. The climate change targets have been adjusted by this Parliament fairly recently, so that's affected our thinking and how we meet what are more stringent targets. So lots of that thinking has been going on for some time. Where we do need a bit more guidance is from the government in relation to zero emissions, for example, what that means, how public sector organisations can go about that, what can be leveraged to those figures, what can't be. So we're still waiting for some of that information to come through. But where we are just now, it's challenging, but I'm reasonably confident that we can put ourselves in a very good position before the end of this parliamentary session.
Okay.
Thank you, Mark. Is that you finished your line of questioning?
I think so, yeah. Unless there's anything more you want to say about actual scrutiny within the Parliament, because I understand, you know, the corporate management of the organisation, but it's just whether you see if there's any more blockages in terms of making decisions about scrutiny.
Yeah, I mean, I think the corporate body will be hugely supportive here. I mean, I think we do need other parts of the organisation to work with us on how things are currently done, what the ideal situation would be, and how we transition all of that. So the session six strategy will contain a lot of information about upskilling MSPs, MSP staff, parliamentary staff in relation to looking at things through a sustainable development lens. But the actual delivery of that will be over to other parts of the organisation. So the corporate body can put framework in place, but work with other parts of the organisation to make sure that these things are picked up with and improvements are made.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. And now over to Liz Smith.
Thank you. Good morning. I wonder if I could ask about COP26, which is obviously a huge international event and one in which hopefully Scotland will be able to demonstrate that she's a world leader when it comes to climate change. But Gil, would you be able to say a little bit about what role you think the Parliament could play in that?
Yeah, we see this as a fantastic opportunity, and it's one that we really want to grasp. We had already secured accreditation for the COP26 that should have been happening now, but we're hoping that we can, having done that, we can retain that for COP26 when it does happen next November. But this is going to be the biggest gathering of this kind in Scotland ever, and probably something that won't see again. So we're really determined to get as much out of this as possible and make sure that the Parliament has a strong presence in all of that. We're aware, for example, that because of the sheer scale of it, there will be lots of activity in the Edinburgh area. So we think putting this building at the centre of all of that would be a great opportunity. We are currently working with a range of national and international partners to develop a programme of events, what we're calling our route map to COP26. And some of the stuff that's coming together there is really quite exciting. We're planning some online events in the early part of next year. We're not going to sit back and wait until COP26 actually happens. And as things go on, and hopefully as we move through COVID, we'll be able to add in some more face-to-face events. We're also using the Festival of Politics, which starts this Thursday, as a hook to look at what our contribution as a country should be to COP26. So the convener is chairing a session, I think, on Friday, the title of which is What Should Scotland's Top 5 Aims Be for COP26? There's an excellent panel there, so we'll be watching that very closely to see what other people's ambitions for that are. It would probably be remiss of me if I didn't also mention that Claudia Beamish is chairing a session about sustainable cities. So again, in the run-up to COP26, we're trying to use the Festival of Politics as an area where we can talk about sustainability, we can talk about environmental performance. Overall, our approach to this will be... Sorry?
You mentioned just now about obviously having engagement with other bodies within the UK and other international bodies. Does that include other national parliaments? Are you engaging with national parliaments elsewhere about what COP26 might involve?
Very much so. I mean, that's one of the main focuses for us, as the events that I'm referring to here. It's at the very early stages of development, but what we'd like to see is an event where we can bring together parliamentarians from across the world to discuss how their parliaments play a role in tackling climate issues, response to climate emergencies, and that's something that's it's like a big prize for us. If we can get that information, it might lead to a step change in how we approach things. But all of this is going to be overseen by the strategy, pillar three of the strategy, which is about engagement. At the moment, it's almost entirely about COP26. The lead officials in there are our head of events, our head of outreach, our key spice researchers. So we've got our senior people in these areas getting their heads together on how we can leverage as much benefit out of this fantastic opportunity that we've got in front of us.
You mentioned outreach there, and Parliament's prided itself over its last 21 years about the quality of the outreach, both in terms of reaching out to parts of Scotland that obviously don't always have the opportunity to come to Edinburgh, but also in terms of the schools programme. And I just wondered what work is being done to assist with young people's understanding of COP26. I mean, they're an extremely engaged generation in terms of the issues. But what are you doing to try to encourage a lot of youngsters in schools to?
Yeah, again, that's very much part of our thinking. We're having to go a bit carefully in this one because of the amount of pressures on schools at the moment. So we can't push too hard on this, but we certainly haven't neglected it either. We've taken a big step back, obviously, in the last few months, but we're now starting to kind of tentatively put our feelers back out again. But again, I think you're right. I think this is a great opportunity to get younger people involved in this massive global event that will be on our doorstep.
Youth Parliament be doing something on that line too?
I'm not entirely aware. I'd be surprised if they weren't, but it's not something I have any knowledge of at the moment. I can certainly find out.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Off the back of what Liz has been saying, asking about engagement in schools, not just relevant to COP26, but one of the really important things that the Parliament does is the schools visits and the work that you do with schools so that young people understand what happens in the Scottish Parliament. Can you outline some of the stuff you've been doing during the pandemic to keep that going? I mean, there is a lot to be said for the physically visiting the building, but people can't do that right now. But there might be if we don't find a way to do that during the pandemic, there'll be swathes of children who don't have that opportunity to find out what their national parliament does. What have you been doing there?
There's not been a huge amount of activity because, as I said, first of all, when the schools were closed altogether, and then when they got back up and running again, we did recognise that they were under a lot of pressure to set up the learning with students coming back in. So we've taken a wee bit of a step back there, but we are now starting to engage again with schools and look at online resources. We're issuing resources for them to use themselves, and our officers are now starting to engage back with schools again. But we're at the early days of seeing how things can be done differently. What I can do though is I can check with the services, the service providers here internally, and and I write to the committee with more detail on what we're actually doing just now and what the plans are to build that up as we continue to live with COVID.
And there might be some lessons as to how we can actually engage more schools that are maybe in sort of like far-flung areas of Scotland that, as Liz mentioned, don't have an opportunity to come down to Edinburgh.
Yeah, that's always been a bit of a problem for us in the extent to which potential to support to from lower income areas or from the extremes. So this has changed things quite radically. It's not all about coming to this building and travelling to Edinburgh. So that's opened up great opportunities for us here.
Claudia, you want to come in with a question on this?
Thank you very much, Convener. David, could I ask you if you could explore with us the connections that you're making with parliaments in the Global South, particularly in view of the fact that the Climate Change Act does highlight our responsibilities as a developed nation to ensure that we recognise that those who've to use the usual phrase of importance that done least to cause climate change are already often very badly affected by it. So I wonder if you could highlight something about that or let us know as things progress. Thank you.
Yeah, more than happy to do that. I mean, our focus building up has been primarily with the other legislators in the United Kingdom, and we've managed to establish very good regular contacts with the other officers that have the responsibility for this. It's a very active network and it shares good practice. But we're taking the opportunity of COP26 to really widen our horizons and to bring in parliaments in the parts of the world that you're talking about into our networks in order that we can learn from them what it's like for them in the situations that they're dealing with and what the impact of environmental performance in our part of the world might be in other parts of the world. So that's something that I'd be more than happy to keep the committee updated with as that develops.
Thank you, that's helpful.
Thank you. I'm not seeing if any other members want to come in. I want to thank you all for your evidence this morning and telling us about what the Parliament is doing and planning. But we'll leave that session there, and if there's anything you want to follow up on that you've mentioned, you can follow up in writing with. That's absolutely welcome. I'm sure we'll continue this conversation. Thank you all. Okay, our third item today is consideration of two notifications from the Scottish Government in relation to consent to UK statutory instruments, and they are the Control of Mercury Amendment EU Exit Regulations 2020, the Greenhouse Gas Emissions Trading Scheme Withdrawal Agreement EU Exit Regulations 2020. Members will recall that there is an agreed protocol between the Scottish Government and Parliament in relation to instruments being made by the UK Government under powers in the European Union Withdrawal Act 2018, which relate to proposals within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament. The Scottish Government and the Parliament have agreed on UK-wide approach to statutory instruments. So the committee raised some queries with the Scottish Government in advance of this meeting, and we have received a response to those. Do any members want to make any comments in relation to any of these instruments? No, I'm not seeing anything. So do members agree to approve the Scottish Government's proposal to consent to the provisions being made in the UK Parliament on these UK statutory instruments? Okay, I'm seeing that you do. Thank you very much. So we are agreed to approve this proposal on these SIs. Our fourth item today is consideration of a negative instrument, the Water and Sewerage Services Undertaking Boiling Scotland Order 2020. Do any members have any comments to make in relation to this instrument or do want to make any recommendations? Nobody has any comments. Oh, Mark.
Yeah, just briefly, Convener, welcome the instrument and the flexibility, the increased flexibility that Business Stream will have through this. I just think it might be worth the next time we have Scottish Water in front of the committee for them to report on the use of these borrowing powers in relation to that aspect of their business within their group. It'd be useful, I think, for us to get a greater understanding about how the state utility is working with the privatised element of its group and how the borrowing power is working.
Okay, we'll note that for the next time we have Scottish Water in front of us. Thank you. Right, I'm not seeing that anyone else wants to make any comments in relation to this instrument. So that concludes our meeting in public today. At our next meeting on the 24th of November, we will consider amendments at stage two of the UK withdrawal from the European Union Continuity Scotland Bill. And that is our public session over. Thank you.